I'm an independent science journalist. I don't write for anybody but myself. And yeah, today I'll tell you about the trachea transplantus and how bad stem cell science led to bad regenerative medicine, and it ended up with patients being dead. I don't know how many of you recognize the person in the background. Does anybody recognize him? Yeah, he's famous. So, wait. Yeah, so it's Paolo Macchiari. And he's a thorax surgeon, originally Italian. He was celebrated as stem cell pioneer, and his last famous job was professor at the Karolinska Institute in Stockholm, Sweden. And he transplanted quite a lot of patients with bioengineered tracheas made from cadaveric scaffold and a plastic scaffold, and they were seeded with bone marrow cells to regenerate them. It ended up with people dead, and the ones who survived are in permanent emergency care. So why did he do it? Well, because trachea is a very interesting organ to transplant. It's a big reward to transplant a trachea, though you would think it's a very simple one, right? So let me tell you first about tracheas. So this is a scheme made by Pierre Delare, who is a trachea surgeon, and he actually succeeded in transplanting them. It's quite difficult. So maybe I should, can you see the slides? Well, so tracheas are obviously a living tissue. It consists of a cartilage fringe on the outside, which stabilize it. On the inside is a ciliated epithelium, which is very important to remove the infections and dirt which you breathe in. And if it wouldn't be there, it would be immediately clogged with dirt and viruses and bacteria and fungi, and eventually kill you. So of course, because it's a living tissue, it needs to be vascularized. It needs blood supply to keep it alive. And there are quite a lot of patients who have tracheal cancer, have congenital defects. Some patients are born without trachea, with a very narrow trachea. They are victims of accidents who have damage to their airway, and they would profit from a trachea transplant. But now the problem starts. Tracheas cannot be transplanted straightforward as a heart or a lung or a kidney for the simple reason they don't have a central blood supply. So with the other organs, you just connect the main arteries and veins, and then it's vascularized, right, when you transplant them. You can't do it with a trachea because a trachea is an example of very unintelligent design, if you want to put it this way. It doesn't have a central blood supply. It receives blood through many capillaries, and no surgeon can connect them. There are too many. Even if they tried, when they finish connecting them, the patient will be dead. You can't have such a long operation. So this is the problem with trachea transplant. It's technically not doable because of the problem with the blood supply. So this is what also Pierre shows us in the diagram. And if you do not assure the blood supply to your donor trachea, it will die right away, and the patient will rot inside the patient and kill the patient. So this is where regenerative medicine comes in, the solution. And it's very simplified, of course. I don't mean to ironic, but this is really how it happens. So what you say, you will grow a trachea out of nothing. Basically, you take stem cells of a patient, you put them on some kind of scaffold, which is dead tissue, and then declare it regenerated to be alive. Next step, of course, you have to transplant the patient, and you have to somehow make the patient grow into the blood cells, into this miracle thing which you grew in the lab by magic. Because it doesn't make sense for blood vessels to grow so quickly to save the dying tissue. It doesn't work like this, but magic happens, according to certain regenerative medicine scientists. The step three is very important. Then once you claim this is a success, you have to collect funding, awards, fame, you go on media, you get promotions, you get professorships and everything, and become very famous. Then a step four happens, then people start criticizing you and saying, well, your trachea are actually not alive, and anyway, they're not vascularized. Then you have to silence them because you said you published in a big journal. And when the patients start dying and becoming very miserable, you just make these patients disappear, or not physically, but you just remove them from the news. You don't talk about them. You talk about the patients who are still alive, for example. And once you succeeded here, you go back to step three. You collect funding, awards, fame, promotions. That's unfortunately how it works. So what's your technology to grow stem cells? Obviously, you need a source of stem cells to grow them, to grow your tracheas. And they have to be patients' own cells. You can't use other cells because one of your selling points is you want to grow an organ which will not be rejected by immune system of the patients. You say, we won't need immune suppressive drug treatment lifelong because it will be patient's own organ. So you have to sell, use patient's own, or pretend to. You probably all know about induced pluripotency, which allows to grow different types of cells, but it's not safe from cancer threat. There are a lot of technological limitations. The method is very new. So, back then people didn't have it anyway. So what you can do instead, you can just ascribe stem cell qualities to whatever you're working in. So whatever cells you're working in, you just call them stem cells. Lots of and then you say they can differentiate the kind of tissue you want. And this is what actually happened in the trachea regeneration case. So I don't know if you know Catherine Verfey. She is a head of the Stem Cell Research Institute in Leuven, KU Leuven, where Pierre Delara actually works, one who blew the whistle on Macchiarini. She recently received an award from the Queen. She used to be very famous. And her fame came from the claim that bone marrow cells are pluripotent. And it's a huge claim. So apparently inside every one of us are pluripotent stem cells which can be used to produce all kinds of tissues. And she published it, of course, in Nature, which makes it, of course, true, because everything which she published in Nature is true, as we know, right? Because it has a huge impact factor, right? 43 or something. This is her, by the way. She was even on a stamp in Belgium, and on the title of a newspaper, because it's in Minnesota, because she made her discovery when she was still in US. So she came back to Belgium and became head of the Stem Cell Institute. Okay. Something happened. It turned out it wasn't reproducible. The bone marrow cells were not really not pluripotent, she claimed. And it turned out that Nature paper was full of data manipulations. So instead of retracting it, Nature allowed her to correct it, which allows the paper to remain in a scientific record. People can quote it, base their works on it, and presume that it's true, because it was never retracted. It just was full of data manipulation. She had to retract a related paper from Blood Journal because that also was manipulated. In the end, we have a zombie Nature paper. We have a zombie scientist, and we know that bone marrow cells are not pluripotent by now. In fact, people don't really know what they do, what they actually are and what they do. They are interesting cells, but definitely not pluripotent and definitely not making all kinds of tissues, like they claim to. So maybe you know this colleague of yours. It's Professor Anthony Hollander here from Liverpool University. He was one of the scientists who was part of this bone marrow stem cell craze, who believed that they are pluripotent, they can make anything of them. Even this is his company, Azelon, and they also say that bone marrow cells are a rich source of adult stem cells and can be used to different parts of the body, so that they are pluripotent, basically. And, he works here in Liverpool. And this is an interesting bit. In 2008, Professor Hollander and a team of scientists and surgeons successfully created and transplanted the first tissue-engineered trachea using a patient on stem cells. It was his technology was applied in this famous 2008 case, which I'm going to introduce to you now, which Macchiarini played a key role in. So 2008, Macchiarini was a head of the clinic in Barcelona, in University Clinic of Barcelona, and he was very keen to transplant trachea, obviously, and he found a perfect patient, Claudia Castillo. She was 30 years old. She was suffering from a tuberculosis, which destroyed one of her bronchi, not the trachea. It's important thing. So her trachea was relatively okay. The problem was within her bronchi. So they misrepresented the case. And she was in danger of not dying. They were all claiming she was dying. She was not in danger of dying. She was in danger of losing her lung in the process. So Macchiarini offered her a miracle cure. He will replace this bronchus, remove the constricted bronchus, and replace it with a regenerated one. So, and this was his team, Martin Burchell, who was back then professor for in veterinary department of the University of Bristol. And he made a trachea in his veterinary lab. You probably can imagine that you're not supposed to make human transplants in a vet lab where you process pig tissues. He did it anyway. He could do it because, not because he had a permission, but because he never asked for permission. He just didn't report it to the authorities. Which he assumed is the same thing as getting a permission. And Philipp Jungeblut was Macchiarini's MD student from Germany. Macchiarini had also adjunct professorship in Germany, so this is his student. And he was the guy who was in charge of preparing the trachea in Germany, learning from the great master how to make it. The result was a Lancet paper. Lancet is one of the biggest journals in medicine, so everything which is in Lancet is true. Just like if everything is in Nature is true, nobody doubted it. People were thinking, yes, how can you make a trachea of bone marrow cells and how it got vascularized? Whoever doubted this, the science, they were telling Lancet, you know, the impact factor of Lancet, shut up. So this is how it worked for many, many years. And in fact, they even published 5 years later a follow-up paper saying that Claudio Castillo was doing great. And it was a full success, which was a blatant lie. Of course, she had complications from the very beginning. The transplant never worked. It had to be kept open, probably was removed meanwhile. She lost her lung last year, after all. Nobody knows how she's doing now because she apparently disappeared completely. So make your patient disappear, very important. She might be back in Colombia where she's originally from. She might be dead, we don't know. So this is a principle they used on her once again. Again, the slide by Pierre Delara. So you take a scaffold. It can be a biological scaffold, a dead patients, dead donors trachea. You remove all the cells of it. You leave just the connective tissue. Or you can make one from plastic. This is Macchiarini's invention. And then this is the regeneration part. So you seed bone marrow cells on top, and you seed some cells from the nose or upper airways on the inside, transplant it to patients, and say the blood supply will grow out of nowhere. This is Claudio Castillo's trachea in the University of Bristol in the veterinary lab. The image was, I don't know, I think they already removed it from the site because they also destroyed all the evidence, actually. The University of Bristol destroyed all the lab books. Or they claim so that they destroyed it. But they don't exist. So, yeah. And this is Martin Burcher again with a plastic, holding up plastic trachea made by Alexander Seyfalian here from UCL. So they had big plans of using plastic material to transplant patients. I'll explain to you why later on. So first, of course, a scientist or even a surgeon would be asking a lot of questions in the process when they read this Lancet paper on Claudio Castillo. Why would bone marrow cells build cartilage rings around the dead decellularized trachea? Why? How do they know they have to build rings of cartilage? How do they know they have to become cartilage? Well, because it's magic. Magic developed by Anthony Hollander and also other scientists, like Augustinus Bader from Germany, a friend of Macchiarini's. So another question would be, how would they survive without blood supply? Well, because magic happens. Because somehow the blood supplies grow in just in a couple of days, and save the tissue from suffocating. And they help it with erythropoietin. This is their new technology, which Macchiarini developed together with Augustinus Bader. Erythropoietin is a very dangerous substance to give to patients because it causes blood clotting, you know? When you have a transplant patient and you give them a blood clotting agent, it's a bit counterproductive. But they did it anyway because Macchiarini decided a erythropoietin makes the blood vessels grow. So he just decided that it does. And then they grow out of nowhere. They're invisible, actually, because when you analyze it, so here with a probe, you don't see any vascularization. But that's how it works. So how can, another question, when Macchiarini started to use plastic, how can plastic, really the same plastic which you use for cork bottles, for lemonade bottles, become a living tissue? And why doesn't it, plastic destroys all around organs and all? Because the trachea is not a fixed tube in your throat. It's a moving organ. It moves together with all the organs. Every time you turn your head, you breathe, it's moving. So if you imagine you have hard plastic tube inside you, it will move every time you move, and it will tear everything apart around you. It will destroy your esophagus, it will destroy lungs, it will kill you by internal hemorrhage, eventually. And this is what happened to Macchiarini's patients. So how can this become living tissues? Because it's magic. It's nanotechnology, you know? Nanotechnology is a key word in science, it can do everything. So if it was just normal plastic, yeah, it would be dangerous, but it was nanotechnology plastic. So, and of course there are practical considerations which Macchiarini and also Macchiarini used. So bioreactor needs a lot of approvals. You need a good manufacturing practice laboratory to use it. You can't use it in a pig lab, obviously. And after Macchiarini decided not to use it anymore, probably because they had a scare in Bristol. They were found out that they were using storing cells. They didn't know they were making trachea. They told them you can't even use store cells. You have to remove them right away. So they put the trachea on the plane, flew to Barcelona, and transplanted the patient. So after the scare, they decided not to use bioreactor at all and just use the next patients. Kieran Leach, maybe you heard of him. I will come to him later on. They received stem cells and erythropoietin straight into their throat. So Macchiarini was suturing the dead trachea from a donor into this patient, and then he was just painting some cells on top, erythropoietin, and that's it. Magic happened. Another reason why he decided to switch to plastic, he also admitted himself, it takes too long. You know, you need donors. You can't just take it from, dig it out from a graveyard, obviously. You need a donor who agreed to it. Or the family. It takes a long time to decellularize it, and again you need a GMP lab. And GMP labs are very tricky issue. They need to be licensed and everything. So with plastic you don't need anything. You just order your plastic through here, and you sterilize it with radiation, then you can put it in, right? So that's why Macchiarini decided to switch to plastic. This was his first patient, under Marian Bayen. He was a PhD student from Eritrea, who studied in Iceland. He had a form of cancer which was potentially lethal indeed, but he was not dying. His cancer was manageable. It was not curable. He could live for many, many years if treated properly with standard medicine, but Macchiarini declared him dying. He didn't want to be operated. Macchiarini talked him into it. He was telling him, if you don't agree to operation, you will die very soon and you will not see your children grow up. So he agreed eventually. And he died. He died 2 years after the operation. He suffered terribly in process afterwards, and the death was a relief for him. If you saw the BBC document, the experimental, you know, for the patients who received a plastic trachea, death was a relief because they suffered so terribly. So next slide. So. To sum up the trachea transplant by Macchiarini and also Martin Burchell here again. So Macchiarini transplanted 9 patients with plastic trachea. 8 of them died. One survived. He was very lucky. His transplant could be removed without danger to him, because normally when you remove a trachea, you have to replace it with something, otherwise the patient will be dead. That patient who survived had a trachea in his upper throat, so you can still remove this bit. Put a tracheostomy so he can breathe through a hole here. That's why he's still alive. If your damaged trachea is in your chest, the section of your chest, if you remove that, you're dead. You can't be saved anymore. And this is why the other patients couldn't be saved, because they had no air, no way to breathe. You can't do anything with them anymore. You can't help them. So that's the guy was very, very lucky. He's Russian, and he doesn't even understand how lucky he was, apparently, from what I learned. There were around a dozen of patients who'd received a cadaveric trachea, so basically a trachea from a dead donor who was stripped of the cells and seeded with the same stem cell magic. Macchiarini did most of them. Burchell had about three patients of his own. The few who are alive are not cured. The main achievements, they are alive. That's why they're presented as cured. And so I can say they're alive not thanks, but despite the transplant. And one of them is Kieran Lynch, this young boy. So Kieran Lynch case is very special. He was born without a trachea. He received a homograft from his birth. A homograft is a pickled trachea. So it's a trachea for a dead person which was preserved with formalin, for example. And it was an older method development for Martin Ellert. It's not perfect, of course, it's not a function. It's basically a dead tube. But since it's not plastic, it's soft. If you keep it open with a stent, patient can breathe through it. And if you clean it regularly, you can also remove infection. So he was living with it for 10 years. And then the stent inside of his trachea, his stent is a wiring which keeps it open. Okay, started to erode into it, and he almost bled to death. So what they did, they could put another homograft back in. But they decided not to. They decided to use magic. So there was a trachea was made, according to what I learned, in London. They then later said that it was made in Italy. Macchiarini came and transplanted it, put some cells on it, said some magic words, and decided to regenerate it. And the Kieran is still alive. And they present him, his being alive, as a success of this trachea transplant. But if you read this publication closely and you read the whole case, you understand he was saved by the modern stent technology. Instead of the metal stents they used before, which really start destroying eroding tissue, he received a custom-made plastic stent. This is what was saved Kieran. Nobody talks about it. But this is why he's still alive. He has basically a new homograft without any stem cells on it. And his airways are open with a plastic stent. So almost all of these patients were treated as hospital exemptions and compassionate use. And I'll explain now why it's important. So So let's say, back to Scala, you develop a model, a regenerated bioartificial trachea, right? You have to test it on a living organism, right? The proof of principle. You have to face pig or a patient. Pigs, because they have the same size as humans, trachea is similar size, and it's easier to operate on them than on mice. Mice trachea are very tiny. Nobody can operate on them. So pigs are the standard model for airway surgery. Pig versus patient. You will understand here that it's very complicated and not rewarding. It's much better to understand, operate on patients, test it on patients. So as a pig, you need ethics approval for animal experiments. You need to explain scientific rationale before you get the approvals, and it's very, very expensive. You need proper controls. You can't just separate one pig, declare it a success because it survived, or you need untreated pigs, you need comparison with standard therapies, you need the survival rates for pigs. You know how many of the 12 pigs you operated survived your treatment. And you have to report the site, otherwise you cannot publish it. Nobody will take your paper case report of a pig. They will want a proper study, right? So it's difficult. If your method doesn't work, if it kills pigs, you won't be able to publish it anywhere. Media is not interested. Even if your pig survived, they won't report it. And this is a tricky bit, because everybody can do the same. They can get their own pigs, test your method, and say, look, it's not working. They all died. On a patient on the other side, yeah? Unlike with pigs, you don't need any ethics or regulatory approvals to test it on a patient. Nothing. you take a patient, you say this patient is incurable or probably dying. I as a doctor say this patient is dying, so you have to trust me. And you speak with your colleagues in your hospital and convince them that this patient is dying, that your method is the only way to save the patient, and that's it. No ethics approval, no regulatory approval. You get a hospital exemption, you get the patient to sign it, that the patient agrees. You can't tell the patient any kind of bullshit. Nobody will ever find out what you told the patient because these documents are never released. Very rarely, actually. It's very difficult to get them, what the patient signed. So you, like with Andemariam Bayam, you push the patient into agreeing to this operation by telling them they will die otherwise if they don't agree. And then you have your permission. You don't have to finance experiment. They cost you nothing. In fact, you earn a lot of money in the process because you're treating a patient. It's paid by NIH or health insurance. So you get paid. Unlike with pigs, which are very expensive, you get paid. You don't need any controls. You operate one patient. Yeah? You don't have a control, no comparisons with existing therapies because it's a case report. And of course, unlike with pigs where people will ask you, well, what happened? You operate 12 pigs, you only report one of them. Postman. You don't do it with patients. You have one patient, and even if you operated 12 of them, you just reported the one who survived. You let others disappear. They never existed. That's what Macchiarini did with his patients in Italy, for example. They all disappeared. They never existed. Nobody knows their names. Nobody knows what happened to them. Macchiarini said he operated 5 patients in Italy. We don't know what happened to them. And 2 in Barcelona. Second patient disappeared completely. So you report only what you claim as a success. Success is defined by a survivor. Person who is still alive is a success. And of course, nobody can challenge you. Nobody can reproduce it because this is your technology. You got it under hospital exemption. Nobody can, unlike with a pig, they can't test it. They have to trust you and your high impact paper. So another trick is when you do regenerative medicine, you transplant things which nobody can see, like a trachea, right? You can't see, you can't look into your throat and see how the trachea is doing, right? And this is very clever because, so imagine you have a patient who lost his legs, right? Patient can't be cured, no? You can't grow legs, right? Is it a reason to, so then a surgeon comes along, says I can grow legs in lab. Is it a reason to let a surgeon try it? No, of course not, it's silly, but this is what people do with trachea transplant. And if you think this is ridiculous, this is Harold Ott, a regenerative medicine surgeon from US, and he claims to have grown a leg in the lab. And all the media reported it. This is a new scientist. I think also Nature reported it. World's first biolimb. Right? So what he did, he took cut off a leg of a dead rat, stripped it of all the cells, put some bone marrow cells, and decided to call it a leg. Because, of course, it looks like a leg, right? And the journalists were all very excited. And he is with a heart. It looks like a heart, of course, because it's a dead scaffold of a heart, free of cells. But, you know, they just claim, look, we grow a heart, we grow a leg. But this is a trick, you know? He was testing his organs in animals. He was not allowed to operate patients, I think. But he never tested the leg. And why not? You know, that would be interesting. But he never did because he understood that he would look stupid, right? So Pierre de Lara made a comparison with a thumb. It's the same thing, you know? Can you imagine? You take a thumb of the dead patient, you remove all the cells, claim that you regenerate, suture it on somebody's head, just a rotting piece of tissue, right? Everybody, yeah, but this is what they do with trachea. This is exactly what they do with trachea. The only difference is you can't look at it and laugh because you don't see it. So that's what I already mentioned, that it's not an emergency, but yeah. This is what they did for patients with tracheostomy and throat cancers. These patients were stable. They were not dying. They would eventually die of their cancer, for example, of complication of tracheostomy maybe. But what they are offered instead is a magic like this, which killed them very fast. So this is the logic. But this is how you create a hospital exemption. You make an operable patient an emergency. Basically, you tell a patient without a thumb or a leg is inoperable, so I have a method to cure this patient. Right? This is how it works. Another trick, you have to publish very quickly before your patients die or deteriorate. Could happen. You know, so Claudio Castillo was published, success was published very fast in Lancet. And the follow-up paper, they had just to lie to get it published in the Lancet. The follow-up, the five-year follow-up is just a bunch of lies. That's why you have to be very quick, otherwise you'll be in a situation where you have to lie more than usual. This is a paper of Andemarian Bayen, also in the Lancet, the plastic surgery, a huge success. They published it right after they transplanted him, because 1.5 years later he was dead, very miserable. So if they would have waited a bit longer, it wouldn't be publishable, certainly not in Lancet. And this is Kieran Lynch paper, 2-year follow-up. This is where they still pretended like it's a success. The 4-year follow-up paper, which Birch and Elliot published, doesn't look so great anymore. They just say, well, he was dying anyway. It was the last option we had. And we know it doesn't work very well, but still. So it is a huge difference. You get trouble publishing your things if you wait too long, because your patients might die or deteriorate. And this is Richard Horton. He's editor-in-chief in Lancet. And he's a very understanding person, you know. He made an editorial in 2016, I think. Paolo Macchiarini is not guilty of scientific misconduct. So whenever you have doubts of Paolo Macchiarini, you go to Lancet website, you read this, and then you know what's really happening. It's not retracted, it's still up there. He's not ashamed of this. Richard Horton, maybe you know of anti-vaccination crisis which we have. You know of Andrew Wakefield, right? So Andrew Wakefield is a personal friend of Richard Horton. That's why the paper was not retracted for 11 years, because they know each other, they work together in the same hospital. And Richard Horton was working very hard to save Wakefield and not to retract this paper. He was very angry when he was made to retract it after 11 years. So the vaccination crisis is his fault. So another thing is, if your patients die, you have to blame them. It's their fault. So what happens? Cadaver extraction here cause death when transplanted in cancer patients, because cancer patients are already weakened, or very weak patients. And plastic extraction here killed everybody, even quite very strong patients. So Macchiarini did. He blamed the patients for being too weak, because he said, yeah, I don't want to operate cancer patients anymore. They die on me. So I want accident victims, young women who are otherwise healthy, who have a tracheostomy because their trachea is damaged. So they are strong enough to survive my technology. This was his actual argument to do it. So this is his Russian patient, Yulia Tulik. She was pressured also into this operation to receive a plastic trachea, died very miserably. And she was a victim of accident. Only problem was a tracheostomy. She was otherwise perfectly okay. She wanted, when you have a tracheostomy, you have to close it down so you can speak, for example. Every time you want to speak, you have to close the hole. And you can't swim. You can't go into water at all when so the life is restricted over the tracheostomy patients, but they can get very old. She was a young woman, she wanted her life back, and she agreed to it, and it ended her life. This is another young woman. She was a victim of the botched Yesim Çetir from Turkey. She was a victim of the botched operation. She was operated, she had sweaty hands. She went to Turkey to some idiotic surgeon, apparently, who decided to cut her nerves so her hands won't sweat. In the process, he cut her trachea. So she had a tracheostomy. Again, a young woman wanted her life back. Then she meets somebody like Macchiarini, who promised it to her. It ended up, it became a disaster. She died. She was operated, I think, 2012. She died early this year. And until then, she was in permanent emergency care. She had a multiple organ transplant. They had to transplant lungs, esophagus, trachea, the whole chest of a donor patient into her, and it still didn't help save her. So the death for her, both of these women, the death was a relief, and they had actually a normal life. So in this rationale, which Macchiarini used, he wanted to have such patients to prove his technology. And in fact, Martin Birchall does something very similar now, as I will show you later on. So Macchiarini was asked if he is a pathological liar on Swedish television. And he didn't answer it with yes or no. So apparently he understands that he is a pathological liar. So he claims, this is his version of event, all of his patients were very, very, very sick, including, for example, Yulia Tulik, a Russian patient who showed you before. When asked, yeah, what was her grave disease? He said, well, she was very ill. He's just not saying what she had. And he claims he extended their lives. They would have died right away, which is, of course, a lie. And anyway, everything is a conspiracy against him. He's a master, and everybody's just jealous. As I said, 8 of 9 plastic to heal patients dead. Circumstances of several others are unknown. How they're doing? McKinney operated around at least 9 patients with cadaveric to heal. And we only know of these 9 because he admitted to those. So this is one of the cadaveric to heal patients, Jadira Iglikova. This was a showcase in Russia. In Russia, they were so impressed by Claudio Costillo event that they wanted him to come to Russia and operate there and transfer the technology. This was a patient, again, an accident, a victim of the accident. This one was a terrible car accident. Everything was fixed in the end, but she had a tracheostomy. She wanted, again, a life back. Received a cadaveric to him. This is why she's still alive. So she has to get permanent care and everything, and it, of course, the operation failed. But luckily, she is still alive only because she got a cadaveric to him, not a plastic. But of course, she was not cured. This is Macchiarini's partner, Vladimir Parshin, a Russian surgeon who organized all this operation. And this is Martin Birchall. Again, you can't read it here. It's too small. But I will put my slides online. You can see that he is boasting about the Claudio Costillo success. So basically, it was wishful thinking. They kept declaring Claudio Costillo as a success until, I think, end of last year, until everybody understood that this was a lie, that she is not a success. This woman suffered terribly. But this is a poster for parliament. And this is where he's boasting his successes. So you have to control the facts to control the future. So Martin Birchall and his partner Martin Elliott, also from Great Ormond Street in London, they operated 3 pediatric patients with cadaveric to heal. They say everything was Macchiarini's fault. So then the current version, right? So everything bad which happens was Macchiarini's fault. Macchiarini is a really evil person, suddenly. They used to be friends. Yeah? So look, do they look like they hate each other? Of course not. This is Birchall, this is Elliott, this is Macchiarini, of course, and this is Mark Laudel, who made the trachea, the 3 tracheas for, 2 or 3 tracheas for Birchall and Elliott. And then, of course, see, yeah, well, the science of cadaveric trachea, which Macchiarini developed, it's okay. This is solid. This is what Martin Elliott said in the talk this end of last year or this even this year. The science is solid. It was Macchiarini who is not a person who ran away using plastic trachea and everything too quick. But the science is solid. This is what they're saying. Yes, the bone marrow cells magic works, and the vascularization's magic works. Because it's evidenced by the fact that Kieran Lynch is still alive. Yeah? Because they keep, now they ran out of Claudio Costillo as evidence, but they still have Kieran Lynch as a survivor. The fact about Kieran Lynch is his family doesn't communicate with media. Nobody knows how this boy is really doing. The only people who have access to him is Martin Birchall and Martin Elliott. So we have to trust him that he's doing great. Like, and as I said, it looks the boy was saved by the modern stent technology, not by this stem cell magic like they claim. But they just mix things up. So, and the patients who died, well, they had at least their lives extended and improved, which is completely ridiculous. So this is Keziah Shorten. She had a cancer, potentially lethal, but it's a very slow-growing form of cancer. She could have lived for many years. It ended up with her receiving a cadaveric trachea in Italy from Macchiarini, which collapsed immediately and which left her without a trachea, of course. And they had to put a plastic one, and it killed her. So this girl had probably a couple of weeks happiness after the operation where she thought she was cured, and the rest was suffering and terrible misery. She's from Kent, I think. She was 19 when she was operated. This is Shauna Davison. She was 15. This girl was born with many deformations, with one lung constricted. So here, lots of health defects. But her situation was not so desperate. Her doctor said that she's quite stable. She can live for quite some time. No? Well, eventually, she would die because she had too many defects. But she was in a stable condition. She was very happy with her life. Her mother was happy with everything. But they met Martin Elliot and Martin Birchall, and their magic traheas. And Martin Elliot said that it's a huge success because Kieran Lynch is alive. When he was giving evidence to the ethics board to operate on Shauna, he only spoke of Kieran Lynch. He later on admitted he knew of 7 other patients who were not doing great at all. He didn't mention them. So she was operated, and she died very soon after. There was this paper which described Keziah, Shauna Davison, and Kieran Lynch by Elliot and Birchall, where they claimed that they extended their lives and saved them. And it's allegedly a full success. But with Shauna, they say, well, she died out of something. We don't know what. There was no autopsy. Maybe they should read her obituary, which was published in this newspaper. And it clearly says that her trachea collapsed and she suffocated. But yeah, the scientific literature, you know, you have to control the scientific literature. It's a paper. You trust the paper more than you trust anything else, right? So they described how, basically, the paper described how much money you can earn from transplanting tracheas. A lot. And the money is rolling. Your money, actually. Your taxpayers' money is in it already. And they all went to Birchall. So he's preparing 3 public-funded clinical trials with cadaveric tracheas and larynxes, because he's a laryngologist, actually. This is his specialty, the voice box. So the one trial in INSPIRE is funded by Innovate UK with almost $2 million. They're supposed to operate 4 young cancer-free stenosis patients. No more patients with terminal cancer, because they would die. They want young people who are not too old and they have tracheal stenosis. This is incredible. Stenosis patients can be treated very well. Maybe they can't be cured, but there's a plethora of therapies for them to keep them alive in a very stable and good condition and give them a good quality of life. But he wants to operate, take away their tracheas and put in a cadaveric one, regenerated with stem cell magic. And when he was preparing this trial, the patient information sheet contained no information of the past, nothing. It was presented utterly novel model. We don't know what will happen. We are very confident that it will work, but we have nothing. All these dead patients disappeared. They never existed. Tetra, so this is INSPIRE as a phase 1 trial. Tetra is a phase 2 trial. It's progressing. The INSPIRE trial was put on hold, indefinitely probably, but Tetra is progressing. So they're going to, so European Union is funding with almost $7 million, a phase 2 trial for Birchall, again on young cancer-free stenosis patients, without any results of INSPIRE trial, because they didn't even recruit anybody, but they're progressing. So I don't know how it's going to be. So they just extrapolate that it would have worked, so let's operate. I don't know how it will work, but it's. I hope Brexit will stop this. And there's Regenvox, which Anthony Hollander from the University of Liverpool is actually part of. It's funded by MRC with almost $3 million, and the idea is use cadaveric larynxes regenerated with bone marrow cells on 10 patients. This trial is not so dangerous. It will not work medically because the science is still the same. But when you replace the larynx and it doesn't work, nothing happens. So the patient will be back where they were, just with a clump of dead tissue in the throat. You can live without a larynx, but you cannot live without trachea. So this is why this trial is not taken so seriously anymore. The company which runs it is based in Liverpool. It's Videregen. And they run both the trachea transplant trials, the INSPIRE Intensive. They got most of the money. Birchall is paid advisor for Videregen, quite a lot. And this is the Steve Bloor, the CEO, with a model. And this is how they imagine it. It's like with a cast. You know, you have a stenotic trachea, narrowed one. You cut it out, throw it away, and put in something you made in the lab, and voila, it works. So this is how they imagine. It's from their own website. So Macchiarini and Bersh are not the only ones, because as I told you, everybody wants to transplant trachea. And it even looks like Macchiarini inspired a lot of people to transplant trachea. So I'll tell you a bit more of other trachea transplanters. This is in Sweden. Suhitra Sumitran Holgersson. She used to be a Karolinska Institute professor. She was caught on data manipulation there. But she was acquitted because there were formality issues. The investigators didn't make the records, didn't write everything down properly. So on real formality reasons, the whole investigation was thrown out, and she was allowed to keep her professorship at the University of Gothenburg in Sweden. And there she teamed up with the surgeon, Michael Olofsson, that's him. And they started to transplant regenerated veins. So veins stripped of cells, seeded with, I think, bone marrow, whatever she thought was stem cells. She was making up things as she went along. And tested on 3 children. None of them is doing too well. Luckily, they're still alive. And then they were so impressed by Macchiarini, they decided, oh, let's transplant it right here. The patient died quite right after it. So similar technology. They even briefly collaborated. There was a point where Macchiarini was considered to rescue Yasim Chetia with the trachea from them, because she didn't have it anymore. He removed it. So he was planning to use one of theirs, and then he decided against it, to put another plastic on. So most recently, both of them were found guilty of misconduct and unethical human experiment in an investigation by the University of Gothenburg. And let's see how it turns out, what the administrative punishment for them will be. They already had a retraction. The trachea transplant paper was retracted for data manipulation. But they also had an ethics permit. They just lied about ethics permit. Another trachea transplant, Charles Vacanti. Do you know who he is? He's famous. He's an osteologist in Harvard, Brigham and Women's Hospital of the Harvard University. And his big first fame comes with this mouse. You know, this is a mouse with a human ear on it. What he did, he made a scaffold out of some artificial material, sutured it into under the mouse skin, and said, look, it's an ear. Because it looks like an ear. And everybody published it. But, Vacanti had better ideas. He invented STAP. You know, you heard of it, right? Stimulus-induced pluripotency. So you take any cell, you put it into acidic bath with a low pH, and it becomes totipotent. Not just pluripotent, totipotent. This is what they claimed. He and Haruko Obokata from Japan, who was in his lab for some time. And of course, it was exposed. Eventually, people couldn't reproduce it. Nature had to retract 2 papers. It was a huge scandal in Japan, especially. One of the authors killed himself in the process. Sasai was his name. Obokata was sacked. He was sent away on a sabbatical. And the idea was that he's not coming back, but he did. He's back in Harvard. But so this is what we know, but what is well known about it. But less known that Charles Vacanti also wanted to transplant a trachea, probably inspired by Macchiarini's fame. He tried it in 2010. When Macchiarini was celebrating Claudia Castilla and other things. So this was a girl, she was, I don't know, 15, I think. And Vacanti prepared with this guy, Ken Kojima, who also was part of the STAP scam. They prepared a plastic trachea, seeded it with, again, bone marrow cells or something, and sutured it to a patient to be regenerated. And this girl was very lucky, because Vacanti is not a surgeon. As a surgeon, like Macchiarini or Burchell, you're in charge. You can do to the patient whatever you want, because it's your patient. But there was a different surgeon who was leading the operation. He looked at this trachea and said, no, it doesn't look like a living tissue. Let's not put it in. So this girl was saved. Didn't stop Brigham and Women Hospital to issue a press release celebrating Vacanti's development. It was never used on the patient. She was saved by standard surgery, but somehow they're still celebrating because they wanted to be part of the fame, part of Macchiarini's fame. So they don't talk about it anymore, of course. Those people you don't know about, but according to German court, I'm a criminal because I reported about them. They had an injunction against me by a certain judge who doesn't like journalists, especially those with Eastern European names, I think. So anyway, according to this court decision, they made 3 tracheal transplants. They didn't make a whole trachea, just a patch. It was made of pig intestine and regenerated with, well, whatever Wallace decided was stem cells. And according to the judge decision, this, all 3 of these transplants are full resounding success. And if you have any doubts, you'll be sentenced by court. So if you have any questions about the patient's clinical evolution of the transplants or their vitality status, you cannot ask them, because if you start discussing these issues, it is a libel, and you will be sentenced by court, by this court. Another thing, the first patient was transplanted together with Macchiarini. Those are the 2 papers which they published about him. Macchiarini is corresponding author on both papers. He is also PG supervisor of a dissertation of one of the central quarters. So if you want to say that by virtue of being a corresponding author, Macchiarini had any scientific contribution to these publications, you commit libel against Wallace, and you will be sentenced by this court, which happened to me. So I'm appealing this decision, of course. It cost me quite a lot of money. But this is how the German law is. Yeah, so that's it. I would like to thank you. And this is my contact. I'm on Twitter. Email, and this is my website and my email. And I will put it online in slideshow. Thank you very much.